Good evening, everyone, at the first International Science Slam in Slovenia.
We are Aleš Novak and Maja Ratej. Maja is a science journalist working for national and public radio in Slovenia, and I am a stand-up comedian.
So, the Science Slam is part of the EUTOPIA Week organized by the University of Ljubljana and Science Onto the Street Society. EUTOPIA European University Alliance unites 10 European universities aiming to become an open, multicultural, operation of connected campuses by 2025. So this time we are meeting in our lovely Ljubljana, and tonight we are going to experience how science can be a little bit less scientific and a little bit more attractive.
Yeah, so the big question is, who will get naked first?
Aleš, no. You didn't get the point.
No?
You didn't understand it correctly. Tonight, 9 selected researchers are preparing something exciting and unconventional, and I'm sure we will all have great fun.
So that's why these people are behind our back. I didn't...
Yes.
Okay.
They will share their...
They're short 5 minutes long stories about their research from politics to chemistry, from artificial intelligence to geology.
And instead of formulas, there will be piano involved. We will hang flags, do experiments with bubbles and chat with AI. So I assure you, these guys at the back know so many amazing things and can do so many like tasks.
Oh, really?
You can ask them anything they know.
And they will do it?
Yeah.
If I can... I simple task, they will do it.
Try.
Okay. Can you please wave? Wow. I feel so powerful.
Yeah, you can ask them anything.
Really?
Yeah.
For example, like, can you jump? okay, that's a little bit more difficult.
Anything, Aleš.
Is this just my power or also yours? You
maybe,
can say?
Yeah. Can you bow?
Okay. Can you sneeze?
No, please.
Too soon.
This is a public event, sorry.
Okay.
No sneezing involved. It's prohibited.
Okay. And in the end, we will pick a winner.
Yeah.
Okay.
So the last task we can ask them, because we are in Slovenia, it's important that you pick something in Slovenia. For example, can you say good evening in Slovene? Dobar večer.
Dobar večer.
And can you answer them? Yeah. So thank you very much. Give a large round of applause for them. You can leave the stage now and take your seat.
And in the end,
you
will pick a winner.
Yeah, but not only you. There's also a jury as well. We have a very fine jury, so give a big round of applause also for our jury here.
First of all, Michael Mansky from Radio Slovenia International.
And there is Guy Deloni, a Balkans correspondent for BBC World.
Nina Slaček, science correspondent for Radio Slovenia.
There, at the beginning of the row, is Renata Datzinger. She's a TV presenter and an editor of TV show Ugriznimo znanost. Let's bite into science.
And Mojca Delač, our radio host and journalist who weekly shares passion for our brain at the Radio Slovenia.
She's a science reporter for the Ugriznimo znanost science show on RTV Slovenia. So, the vote from the jury will present 60% of the final result, and the rest goes to you in the audience, and of course to those that right now watch us via stream.
Yeah, this we can say hello to all the people, all the millions who are watching around the globe.
Yeah.
If I can understand correctly, this is like Eurovision just for science,
something
like that. Yeah.
I think they watch us from all over, from Brazil.
Really?
To Romania.
From Brazil to Romania. From Croatia to Serbia.
That's, went global.
We went global, totally.
So at the end, everyone from you here in the audience, or also those that watch us via stream, could contribute to the ranking through a televoting system.
So 40-60 is the ratio between the votes, right?
Yeah, I find it weird too, but you know what they say. It's not the voting that's democracy, it's the counting.
Yes, and let's count our jury in a very quick round with a very simple question.
We will go here to present our jury.
Okay. The question will be, it's a very difficult question. You have to think very... What you ate for breakfast?
No. I think we should give them a much better question, Aleš.
Ah, okay. What did you eat for lunch?
No. I would ask them, if you could be, let's say, a serious scientist and one day win a Nobel Prize, what would you win that Nobel Prize for? So what would you like to achieve by yourself if you could be a scientist? So, Renata. you have a time to think because you rushed here very quickly. Maybe Mojca.
You know, I was...
Can you stand up so that
the people in the audience can see you?
Absolutely. Hi. Oh. You know, Maja and Aleš, I was first tempted to say cure for ALS or Alzheimer's. But think about it. You will probably think that it's not possible. But scientists, neuroscientists, still don't know why people sleep. So I think this would be a cool answer, a cool question to answer for Nobel Prize.
Great idea. Nina, what do you say?
Okay. Maybe something very practical, but... how to maybe pull CO2 out of the atmosphere on a huge scales. That would be useful right now.
It's practical, but it's essential as well. Michael, good evening.
Good evening, hi. I grew up in New Orleans in the US. I remember the first science experiment I ever saw was a kid in my neighborhood was killing lizards and trying to bring them back to life by sticking wires in them. And it was a very interesting experiment because I learned to stay away from him and not play with this kid. So it was very useful information. So my wish would be to find a way to protect lizards from cruel children. That would be.
Okay. Was that kid you and you were just talking about?
No, babe.
We support you in your mission.
Thank you.
Guy.
It's already been done. My scientific hero is Shuji Nakamura, and he's the Japanese scientist who created the blue LED, and thus the white LED, because he couldn't have a white LED without a blue LED. You put the blue, the green, the red together, you get white LED. That only happened in the 1990s, and it's changed, I wouldn't say everything, but it's changed a lot. And it has the potential to change a lot more, reducing power consumption around the globe, bringing light to communities which didn't have light before. I've seen it in villages in Cambodia. It's had a huge impact. So he's my hero. I can't replicate anything like that. But what I would like to do is to maybe develop a superpower to persuade people to give up on the idea of car ownership. Because we're moving into a very exciting time where we've got zero emissions vehicles. And this is terrific, but they're only part of the solution. Giving up the idea that we own our own private vehicles is the next step. At the moment, the average car is parked for 95% of the time. So if I could come up with something to change that, that's what I'd do.
Okay.
Petra, good evening.
Good evening. Since I'm most interested in the medical field and I'm preparing a show about the proton therapy, which is an advanced treatment of cancer, I think I would try to find a way to achieve better treatments for cancer, to be less invasive and to have less side effects. So that would be my goal. Okay. Thank you.
And the last part of the jury, Renata.
Hello, good evening. I would like to say you already told everything what is really important, but I think that the science of aging is very popular right now and that everybody would like to live longer and we would like to have more quality life in our, I don't know, when we are older. So I would like to find some kind of cure or whatever, how to stop ourselves to get old and how to be in a good shape when we're old.
Thank you very much, Renata. So this was our jury. Give one big round of applause for them.
Okay, now we know why this event is called EUTOPIA, but let's move to real business. I have a question for our audience. Be sincere, please. I assure you it won't be taken seriously. How many of you in the last 5 minutes thought about your phone, mail, messages, and so on?
So how many of you felt this urgent desire to touch your phone, to check it? Raise hands, please. So at least a half of the audience here. Yeah.
Yep.
So in Slovenia, 97 of 16 to 74 year olds uses a mobile phone. 81% of mobile phone users used a smartphone. This is a Slovenia fact.
Did you know? Sounds familiar? But anyway, have you thought about what all do we do with this thing here? So with the phone. Years ago, it was invented to
talk.
Yeah. But now we mostly send messages, write mails, listen to music, watch videos, receive voice or video. I mean, if you talk with younger generation, they won't say, call me anymore, or this is so retro. They will just say, send me a message or even tweet me.
But not just this, we don't just communicate via this thing, we communicate with it. So remember Eliza in 1966, and since then, this tool developed to a really sophisticated level.
I'm not so sure, because last time I was bored and I asked Siri to talk dirty with me. You know what she replied?
What?
This carpet needs vacuuming.
Okay. Doesn't matter. Our first researcher, I think she would agree with you. She is Micaela Gargiulo.
Gargiulo. You have to say Gargiulo.
Okay.
Just put yourself.
Gargiulo.
Imagine you're in Italy.
She is a language enthusiast made in Italy, based in Germany. She is fresh in her PhD. She started it just a month ago. From October 2022, she is a PhD candidate at the Faculty of Roman Studies in Dresden and will today in her speech defend the idea that in-depth linguistic analysis of human-computer interactions may shed new light on language in new communicative environments.
Okay. Micaela?
Yeah, she comes from Sorrento, near Naples, and she enjoys the view on Mount Vesuvius every day, she says. She likes to listen to true crime podcasts and wonder why all online assistants are female.
Micaela, the floor is yours.
I recently broke up with my boyfriend, and jump on to Siri. There was a system on this phone. One day, I came home early than usual, and everything sang, "Hey Siri, dream, monkey, biting, heart, meaning." Weird, right? But we would probably do the same. So raise your hands. If at least once in your life, you try to look up the title of a song that you weren't quite sure of, and you start something like a Siri or Alexa, title of the song, because crying baby blue, or any, are you okay? Anyone? Raise your hands.
Thank you. Is it better now?
Yes.
All right. So I saw that some of you were raising your hands, and I've done this before. I've done 100 times myself, so I definitely know the feeling. But let's get back to my ex. I'm not sure whether he found what he was looking for, but one thing is for certain. He would have probably felt awkward to ask me the same thing, or at least he would have phrased it differently. Because when we interact with computers, or more specifically with voice assistants and chatbots, different rules are applied, different expectations take place. Greeting forms like hello and goodbye tend to be replaced by commands like start and quit. We tend to be less formal, less inclined to accept misunderstandings. We even feel entitled to be rude. They are software. They don't have feelings after all. However, even though we are joking, this tendency to harass our bots reflects deeper social issues. Especially if you consider the fact that the more human-like digital assistants are, the higher the chance that programmers will assign it a gender and it would be female by default. Think about Alexa and Siri, for example. And this preference seems to have less to do with voice and other characteristics, and more with the idea of women as naturally predisposed to support, assist, and help. Now I have a question for you. Is it really necessary to assign AI a gender? My answer is no. Because by assigning a gender, we say something about the role we expect them to play, spreading bias about gender, about the role in our societies. You may have started to wonder by now, why is a person from Roman studies talking about computers tonight? I'm talking about this subject because there are actually many studies being made on artificial intelligence, but there's still a lack of research on why, on how these programs can and should be programmed from a linguistic perspective. And it's actually what I'm doing within my research project. By analyzing the language outputs from human-computer interactions, I try to identify the bias in the algorithms and provide guidelines for the development of more effective, engaging, and inclusive technology. I get my time is up for tonight. Hey, Google, who's going to win the Science Slam tonight?
I've searched the web. The answer is...
Yes.
I'm giving you a virtual hug right now.
Damn. Thank you, everyone. Enjoy the Science Slam.
Yeah. That was Michaela Gargiulo from Italy, now based in Germany.
So one big round of applause for Michaela. So tonight me and Aleš, decided to be helpful a little bit and introduce you to some basic tips we learned throughout our careers about science communication.
Yes, as a stand-up comedian, I feel perfectly competent for that.
Well, our first tip today is very simple. Know your audience. I mean, if you don't know who are those that are sitting there in front of you, then it's just like you would be throwing darts at a dartboard with no light. For example, three,
with no light.
With one.
No... Ow. Maja, come on. You need to practice more.
Sorry, I worked at home, but it worked perfectly. I don't know what happened now.
You didn't have anyone.
Is it okay? Yeah,
it's
sorry.
It's going to be
sorry.
Okay.
Sorry, next time. So.
Yeah, next time. There will be no next time.
So, if you want to be effectful while delivering your message, imagine the people in the audience asking themselves a very simple question.
Yeah, how long is this going to take?
No.
Yeah,
beside that, I mean the question, so what? Or maybe the question, what's in it for me? If you could provide them a satisfactory answer, then you are on the right track.
So let's try this with the next presentation. It deals with what?
It deals with cavitation.
Okay. Not a single clue what this is.
Okay, then I'll help you a little bit. It deals with bubbles.
That's better.
Yeah? So how could we make bubbles matter to you, Aleš? Why are bubbles relevant to you?
If I first think of bubbles, it's mineral water. No, beer. That's
beer,
better.
Beer, yeah? That sounds better. I'm not surprised at all. Did you know... Slovenia fact. Did you know that Slovenes drink around 26 round liters per beer per year on average, and that there are around 70 breweries in our country?
26 liters
of
per
beer.
Year.
Yeah.
That's me with the guys after football every week. Did you know that there are more than one way of opening the bottle of beer? You can do it with your bare hand. You can use a chainsaw. I did it. It's great, very effective. You can also use the heel of a woman's shoe. I'm mentioning this because there is a whisper that the second researcher here tonight will show a breaking bottle trick and I can help.
Okay, yeah, but these are not the bubbles anymore. We started at the beginning, now you're bubbling. Okay. But bubbles are really fascinating. Mateusz Duller will now join us with a vision how we could make and use bubbles in wastewater cleaning.
Exactly, mineral water and bad digestion.
Yeah, I think that Mateusz has something else in mind.
Okay.
But when Mateusz doesn't deal with bubbles, he loves to ski and play with Lego bricks. And another fun fact, he became one of the youngest professors at the University of Ljubljana. Beside that, he is a great mentor. He led two projects for the European Space Agency, and twice he received a European Research Council project.
Bacteria and viruses, beware, hasta la vista. Here comes the bubble terminator, Mateusz Duller.
Yeah? Okay? So good now? Yeah. Okay. I just need 3 more seconds and then I can start. Sorry. Okay. So before every talk, I like to stretch my fingers. So that's my routine. But today, I would like all of you to do this with me. Okay? So when I say 3, crack your fingers. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Ah, that sounded nasty. So, believe it or not, what happened were bubbles. Thousands of bubbles just popped inside your fingers. And we call this phenomenon cavitation. So you could hear it, so that's nice, but it would be really cool if you could see it. And now, pay good attention, because if you're oblique, you'll miss it. Ready? Ah, made a mess. Told you I should be the last one. Sorry about that. So, did you see it? No, probably not. Because what happened in there were bubbles appearing and disappearing within 1 millisecond. And to see them, what we need to have is high-speed cameras. We don't have one here, so I prepared a small presentation what just happened. So when I hit the flask moved down, and the water kind of tried to stay at place. And because of that, we got a tension wave, water became under tension, and what happened is, we got almost vacuum at the bottom. And because of that, the bubbles begin to grow. So this looks something like this in slow motion. So it takes kind of a long time, still under 1 millisecond, for the bubble to grow. But then the water stops, right? And at that moment, a pressure wave comes back to the bubble. Bubble cannot take it. And what happens is, the bubble implodes. The walls of the bubble hit each other, and the pressure inside it rises to about 100 megapascal. That's about 1,000 times higher pressure what we have here right now. At that moment, we have the shockwave, something like what you've heard right now. But what happens is we have this shockwave traveling at about 5,000 kilometers per hour, hitting the wall of the bottle and breaking it. And this is what happened in your fingers. So that's one experiment you don't want to repeat, right? Okay, so cavitation was discovered by Newton. So these guys basically screwed us over for gravitation and cavitation. And engineers really hate it because it damages pumps, turbines, valves, even rockets literally fell out of the sky because of these bubbles, right? So there's a really, really big dark side to these bubbles. But our research is thinking, can we maybe turn the bubbles around, away from the dark side, and use their force to help the humankind in some way? And this is what we do. And the story starts basically in your bathroom. So you go to the toilet, you do your thing, and you forget about it, right? But this black hole that everybody has in his house or her house leads someplace, and it leads to a wastewater treatment plant. So a lot of this waste, nicely called, comes to the wastewater treatment plant, and a lot means about the size of this auditorium every hour. So that's a lot of stuff that needs to be cleaned. And we figured out how to clean it, not we, the engineers before us. What we do, what they do, is they use mechanical and biological treatment of water to clean it up. But the problem is some of this waste still remains, and even the bacteria who usually likes to eat this shit doesn't really like it. And the problem is quite simple. I have some example here. So we have this nasty stuff which is gathered in these pools. The bacteria comes, it smells it, it smells really, really nicely, but when it wants to eat it, it's kind of hard, right? So what we figured out is maybe if we use bubbles, if we use our device and push this sludge through the water, what we can do is help the bacteria eat it faster. So we made a device which looks nothing like this thing here. So that's just for demonstration. If it will work, it doesn't work, unfortunately. So this would be mixed up and the bacteria would eat it nicely. But the problem with it is when it eats it, it starts building up gas. So, the bacteria really cannot keep the gas inside itself, right? So it's producing more and more gas. And the nice thing about it is it's biogas. More or less it's methane. And we can harvest that methane. Bacteria goes there and then starts to let me just prepare this. It starts producing methane, a lot of it, and really, really fast. And we learned how to harness it in our pools. And by this, what we get is free energy from bacteria. And we get so much energy that we can drive our cavitation devices and produce even more to heat up other stuff. So basically, we're using the bacteria for free energy, green energy, by the power of bubbles. Thank you.
So,
this was Mateusz Duller.
That was in Bubbles We Trust.
One large applause, round of applause for Mateusz. Did anyone manage to make a photo of that trick with fire? Was anyone so quick with your mobile phones and so on?
That's not a mobile phone. That's
otherwise, we will ask Mateusz to repeat that just for the photo, okay? At the end. It will come at the end, just once more. Okay. Well, in just 2 days, Ljubljana will shine with Christmas lightning. And every time I'm so excited when I observe all those geometric bodies above my head, from spheres to cubes. I mean, there is so much in this combination of art and science.
See, I never thought of that. When it comes to Christmas fare, it's better to stick with good old mulled wine.
No, but I mean it. I mean, art can be very helpful when communicating science. Think about genius illustrations or orchestra symphonies or maybe theater shows for children.
I agree, but it's also helpful when you try to improve your reach and appearance on social media. I mean, you must be strategic.
Okay, so explain me how.
For example, TikTok. Do you know TikTok?
Yeah, I know.
If you plan just to say something into the camera on TikTok, nobody would listen to you. Nobody would listen to that. TikTok is entirely different world. If you want to become popular there, you have to include dancing and singing.
So meaning dancing and singing about science?
If you say something in between, even better. But dancing and singing is the most important. And that everybody will sing and dance on your theory.
Okay. Huh? Well, we'll see that later. So art can be very helpful when it comes to promoting science, especially in Slovenia. And here comes another Slovenia fact. There are more than 5,000 cultural societies in Slovenia, like folklore groups, choirs, bands, theater and dance groups, painting groups, and so on, in which 100,000 individuals are involved. Every 12th person in Slovenia plays an instrument.
And so does also the next researcher, Maximilian Weil. Can we ask you for a little bit of demonstration?
So okay. That this piano won't be so alone and lonely here.
I'm not giving a piano concert, right?
Just 15
yes,
seconds.
Yeah, 15, 20 minutes would be okay. End of playback. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Maximilian Weil will use the piano to show us the trick of detecting weak infrastructure with the help of vibrations.
So yeah, Maximilian is currently in the third year of his PhD at the Universities of Brussels, aiming at implementing machine learning solutions for structural health monitoring for large civil assets. He has both a mechanical engineering and an artificial intelligence degree from the University of Leuven.
And now we will call him with the power of sound and vibration.
So prepare your hands, your ancient instruments as you are paid for, and send a giant and loud vibration, good vibrations, for the next performer and scientist.
Maximilian Weil.
We've been building huge structures to overcome the hardships of nature. But unfortunately, most of these structures, they tend to fail and collapse if they're not monitored properly. So, what can we do about this? Well, every structure, it tends to vibrate to its own beat. Take, for example, this wind turbine. When the wind blows on the wind turbine, the blades will turn, and this will generate green electricity. But unfortunately, if you looked closely, you could see the structure vibrates. So the whole structure vibrates like this when the wind blows on it. So whilst most of these vibrations are harmless, or as the Beach Boys would call them, those are the good vibrations, some vibrations can indicate that the turbine is building up damage in its structure. Let's call those bad vibrations. But now the question is, how do we discern good from bad vibrations? Well, that's where my research comes in. By placing sensors in the top, the middle, and the bottom of this wind turbine, it's possible to measure the vibrations and detect when changes occur. How do we do this? Through machine learning. I'm sure everybody here has probably already heard of the term machine learning, but it's always quite hard to know what does it exactly mean. Well, in this case, think of it as a pianist. I'll give another demonstration.
So the pianist goes to his piano and he plays a tune. Okay, he hears this tune is good, the piano is on tune. So this piano was on the tune. But if our pianist continues playing on this piano and at some point he hears that the notes are out of tune, he will hear this and ask for retuning of the piano. Well, just in the same way, our machine learning system is listening to the vibrations of this wind turbine and will then detect when these are out of tune. And that's the moment where inspection or maintenance is needed. So now that I've got your attention with this kind of crazy comparison of a piano and a wind turbine, I'll highlight you the two main challenges that we face with our detection. So first of all, you've seen I didn't let you hear any bad vibrations. Well, that's because if I want to let you hear out of tune notes on the piano, I'd have to damage it or maybe even destroy it. And I'm sure the University of Ljubljana won't be very happy with me if I do this. Well, and just in the same way, it's impossible to let our system know what bad vibrations are of the wind turbine without damaging it. The second challenge arises when we move the piano from one room to another. So let's say a very famous pianist has a concert today in Ljubljana and plays in a very nice concert hall. And next week he has a concert in Brussels. But he only likes to play on his favorite piano. He moves the piano from one room to another, and the piano sounds differently. But that doesn't mean the piano is damaged. That's because there was a change in the acoustics or a change in the environment. And just like this, our wind turbine will see many different environments. So the vibrations during a breezy, warm summer day will be very different than the vibrations observed during a windy, cold winter day. So that's are the two main challenges. But then, why do we care so much about this? Well, the timely detection of the out-of-tune vibrations can prevent long-lasting inefficiencies and damage buildup in our wind turbine. And just like this, we can also measure detect out-of-tune vibrations in all types of structures. And this means that we can prevent the failure of bridges, dams, or wind turbines and help these last much longer. And that just sounds like music to my ears. Thank you.
The one and only Maximilian Weil.
Applause. Now, with the next presentation, we will switch to politics. The next researcher chose to talk about banal nationalism, a concept in politics known from the 90s. It points to the practices, rituals, and symbols that build a certain, mostly national community.
Or say it simply, who is the member of our gang? Who is ours?
Even in science communication, there is a way of tribalism, which is especially visible when scientists are trying to communicate with the broader audience about sensitive matters, such as to vaccinate or not to vaccinate, or whether the climate changes are real or not. And this tribalism is particularly visible when it comes to jargon.
And that's the first deadly sin in science communication.
So, scientists use certain terms that are perfectly clear to them, but the public understands them differently. Let's make an example about from the climate changes. What do Aleš understand, for example, if I say positive feedback?
Thank you.
Yeah, see? What about if I say uncertainty?
Life.
What if I say carbon?
Tour de France, carbon bicycles.
What about if I say aerosol?
Perfume.
Yeah. What about if I say warming?
Fireplace.
What about if I say cyan?
It's a sign, you know?
Okay. And last word that came into my mind, it's manipulation.
Donald Trump.
Yeah, see, we are totally on, in different directions. So jargon serves a useful purpose, but only to the insiders. To communicate more broadly, you need to translate in everyday words to get your message across. And with the next presentation, we will check how much we are insiders or outsiders in our national states. Is it common language that makes the feeling of togetherness, or the use of national symbols, or songs, patriotic clubs, or sporting events?
Speaking about sports, here is another Slovenia fact. Slovenia is a great sport nation. According to Greatest Sporting Nation portal, Slovenia ranks first in the world if you follow the results in terms of number of residents.
So sport definitely divides, defines us.
Of course. So sports definitely plays an important role in the terms of banal nationalism in Slovenia. Many politicians use it skillfully as they like to appear as runners with flags in their hands.
And so Ivan Lo Giudice, I hope I pronounced it correctly, knows that too. When he is not equipped with flags, he is a PhD candidate in the humanities, and his thesis focuses on Catalonia and cultural identity there. He has carried out his PhD studies between Barcelona and Venice and considers himself a great supporter of the EUTOPIA Alliance. He has two superpowers, he says. He has a daughter and is one of the few real inhabitants of Venice.
Ivan, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thank you very much. So my presentation is about banal nationalism, which is a concept of social sciences and political sciences. I think it's a really cool title for a presentation, but as they said, it's not my own title. It's the title of a book published in 1995 by Michael Billig. So what it means by banal nationalism, so this adjective, is that nationalism goes under the surface. It can be unnoticed. So the starting point is that state nationalism needs a state. But the state is not something natural. It's something artificial, okay? So it's something built. How can a state put into practice this nationalism, this banal nationalism? So states use symbols and objects, every kind of things that we use in our daily life. So we talked about sports, for example. I have a couple of objects here that I would like to use to make a couple of examples, okay? So, see if somebody from the audience can tell me what's this flag? Recognizes this flag? Señora, Catalunya, Catalonia, no? Okay, so according to banal nationalism, Michael Billig talks a lot about flags. Flags and flagging the flags. Okay, so some objects go unnoticed in our daily life. So this means that they kind of belong to our community, to our environment. We don't notice them, okay? So if, for example, if we do notice a flag, okay, a Catalan flag or another flag, so it means that maybe that object is not really part of my, of the idea of the world that I have, okay? Or maybe it's not really part of the environment where I find it, okay? So this is on one side, okay? Banal nationalism applied to a nation. Okay, so as I said, it's usually applied to state nationalism, but it can also be applied to nation or also other entities. So let's do another example. I will help you. This is not a flag. I don't know if you can see it, but it's a towel, a beach towel. And this is really relevant because Michael Billig talks about objects, daily life, okay? So do you know this symbol?
Venice.
Venice, okay? So this is to say another thing. Some symbols, for example, we always talk about flags in this kind of area. Flags hanging outside of a public building, public administration, they go unnoticed usually. Okay, so this is a flag you will find in Venice, hanging outside public buildings. But the same symbol of the lion on a towel, same symbol, but in another object, not a flag, but a towel or something else, may transfer a different meaning. So, for example, this is something that in Italy you may find in some political manifestation, political ideology applied to right-wing or extreme right-wing parties. Okay? So something that maybe at first time we could not really imagine, especially if it's, you know, something related to a culture we don't really know, or not, of a foreign culture. So yes, that's all. To sum up, okay, banal nationalism is about objects that transfer meanings, and we as receivers sometimes we get these messages passively, okay, and at the same time symbols they change meaning. According to the place where they can be found, and according to cliché, or according to the observer bias. Okay, so I hope this short presentation has given you some input, some, I don't know, new ideas, and maybe next time you go out and you see a flag flagging, you will think about this. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, there is one thing we haven't mentioned tonight.
Yeah, where is the toilet? So you go down the stairs and left.
Okay, thank you very much. But I didn't mean that. I mean, we didn't mention the stories.
Oh, storytelling is something where I'm really good at.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely. When you arrive late at home, having too many beers with your friends, you absolutely need to be a very good storyteller.
Oh yeah, I can imagine. But being able to tell a concise, interesting, and even entertaining story with a sort of tension or conflict could help you a great deal to spread the word about science.
And the next researcher will do exactly that.
Absolutely. Now, she will bring something like this.
Some granite cube.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't know I need to bring my helmet with it.
No, no, no.
First darts, now bricks.
No. No worry. With the next story, we are going to pay we're not going to pay tribute to Slovenian protesting movement here, but we will travel to a very, very distant past.
All the way to dinosaurs.
No, not that distant past. Oh. I meant more like we will travel 2.5 million years ago with the help of this stone. So it will guide us through fascinating geological history. And when speaking about geological history, I think it's time for another
Slovenia fact.
So, did you know that exactly on this day, a very famous Slovenian, a noble Baron Žiga Zois was born? He was very important, very smart, very rich, and he supported lots of great Slovenian minds. And beside that, he loved rocks, geology, and especially minerals. And there is one mineral that is called after him. So it's called Zoisit.
And now it's really time to meet the next researcher. Daniela Constantin from Romania will present us the story of quartz, a mineral millions of years old.
Yeah, her research is carried out in the Progress Project, ERC, Consolidator Grant. She said we have to mention this urgently.
Okay. Daniela, please, the floor is yours.
Good evening. So come, please join me in a journey to see the world in a grain of sand. More precisely, a grain of quartz. So, have you heard about mineral quartz before? Yeah, all right. So, quartz is a very durable and very abundant mineral at the Earth's surface. One can find plenty of it in the rocks, on the top of the mountains, or in the sediments, in the sands, in the loess. You can find it in the soil, and you can find it in the dust, floating in the air, or on the dust on our boots. So quartz is everywhere. It is a mineral. It's a simple structure composed of atoms of silicon and oxygen, very nicely ordered. Natural quartz crystals are perfect, but not quite, because perfection is dull, and nature is not like that. So, if one atom of oxygen out of the billions in the quartz structure is missing, or if one atom of silicon is replaced by another type of atom, such as aluminium, and this happens all the time in nature, we call this an imperfection or a defect in the quartz structure. And these defects are what scientists, or at least some scientists, love, because they are giving the key properties of the quartz mineral. Let's take, for example, the iron impurities in the quartz crystals that give the beautiful bright color of the amethyst, which is also a type of quartz. In the field of earth sciences, such defects in the quartz crystals are also used to measure geological time. But how is this possible? Well, these same defects that give the beautiful colors of the crystals can also be used to store the energy. They are like batteries, and they store the energy resulted from the interaction with the natural radioactive field. This energy builds up in time, and in the laboratory we can measure it. Thus, the tiny quartz crystal can record time as well. You can see them as tiny little clocks. So in this progress project that I'm a part of, we are looking at the defects within the quartz crystal and look at how they change in geological time. Geological time meaning stretches of time well beyond the human lifetime, up to billions of years, so more far than dinosaur, much, much more far in time than that. So it's time throughout which the tiny quartz crystals were formed. They were crystallized from the molten magma. They formed the rocks of the continental crust. The continents moved, they bounced, and out of these rocks, the mountains were formed. And with time, nature reshaped these mountains, and they eroded, maybe until their demise. So consequently, such rocks from the, let's say, from the peaks of the mountains, in time, they were gradually eroded and broken down into smaller pieces. And out of these small pieces, the quartz grains were gradually released. And they were picked up by the wind or by the waters. And they were transported by rivers for distances such as thousands of kilometers until they reach a final stage of deposition, which can be a grain of sand on the beach, on the towel where we spend our summer holidays. In the laboratory, we are looking at how these defects in the quartz change throughout these stages. This enables us to be geology detectives. And by looking at a single grain of quartz washed away on the beach, we are able to reconstruct its journey in time and in space. Thank you.
We always have to go around, or we can just, no?
We will figure out.
Daniela, thank you for this fantastic journey into the past.
Now, Aleš, a question for you. Are you comfortable with numbers?
Yes, I could say so. Once I tried to earn €1 million from scratch, so the project was called From Zero to Million.
Oh, really?
Yes.
And how many zeros did you manage to achieve at the end?
Just one.
Just one?
Yeah.
So you earn just 10 euros?
No, just zero.
Oh.
Without one in front of it.
Oh, that's sad. I mean.
No, that's good. You could be below zero. That's success in business, you know?
Okay.
From zero, how many tax do you pay? Zero.
Okay, but anyway, how did you manage to survive on with the zero?
Simple, I quit the numbers and switched to stories.
Okay, smart. But because there is another deadly sin in science communication.
Using zero?
No, I meant more like using excessive statistics. Okay. Too many numbers, too many graphs, too much data. It's a one-way ticket to disaster.
Yeah, exactly. Just look at the climate changes. If there would be no graphs, no 1.5 degree up, no 1.5 degree down, we would be in ice age.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, people really don't get on with numbers on average, but not if you are Slovene.
And here is another Slovenia fact.
Did you know that in Slovenia, every year more than 130,000 pupils and students take part in math or physics competitions? And if we add their mentors and parents, we can make a hypothesis that at least a quarter of Slovenes fancy math, at least a little bit.
And for those, the rest can take a nap. I'm just kidding. Comes the next presentation.
24-year-old Neil Roche Vidal from the University of Warwick in Belgium really loves math. He now studies in UK and lives in a street that reminds him of Harry Potter scenery, says. He will now show us a beautiful dance between numbers and chemistry.
Besides that, he's a chemist and enjoys in philosophy.
Especially reading Nietzsche and Schopenhauer, he says. Neil, we are very happy to hear some more.
Okay. Hello, I'm Neil. I'm the number guy. I will try not to use many numbers tonight, maybe a little bit. And as they have said, yes, I do numbers, but I also do chemistry. My group, the Chaplin group in the University of Warwick, they are experimental chemists. They wear white coats and play with smoky vessels and flasks inside fume hoods. And the ALDC group in Belgium, they are computational chemists. They simulate chemical procedures from their desks and computers, hence the numbers. Both of them are chemists, but their routines are worlds apart. Me, as a joint student, I try to keep it an in-between, but not put the laptop on the laboratory or the flasks in the office. I came today to talk about our last published work about the activation of carbon monoxide. You've probably heard of carbon monoxide before. It's the smoky gas that comes out of your car, very toxic. And it also happens to have one of the strongest bonds known by science. That's super cool, isn't it? You can picture a chemical bond like a string, like this. Some of them are looser, more flexible, easier to break, and others, like carbon monoxide, are more tight and difficult to break. Now, chemists, we like to break old bonds, and form new ones. That's our job in a nutshell. And in order to break strong bonds like carbon monoxide, we attach metals to them, so it pulls energy of it, making it weaker and easier to break. Well, probably you don't care about that, but there is people who do, actually. Every year we are producing 30 billion metric tons of acetic acid and formaldehyde, very important chemical compounds that are made by activating carbon monoxide. And that's a very large amount, very huge. To picture it, it's like 500,000 Titanics in weight. That's a lot. And since we're going to make so much of these compounds, we better find efficient ways of doing so. And here's where we come in. We were a couple of years ago in our group attaching metallic scaffolds to carbon monoxide, very similar ones. But when we looked at the activation of the carbon monoxide, it was completely different between them. The simpler ones, like the ones used in industry, activated it a little bit. But as we increased the complexity, the extent of activation also increased. And to illustrate these more complex structures, I would like to call two of my colleagues, Spila and Ivan, to define these more complex structures. Simple molecules like water or carbon monoxide are like balloons, freely floating around the chemical space. But we were using Rotex sands, which look like this. So a Rotex sand is not shaped like a balloon, but like a donut, like this thing in here. And it's threaded by a long string, a molecular string, with bulky things in the end that stop it from going out and around the chemical space. Give it a go. I love this. All right, thank you very much. Big applause, please. Thank you. Now, when we attach rotaxanes to carbon monoxides, the bonds were becoming more activated, but we asked ourselves why. So we conducted a computational study, and with the quantum software, we analyzed these molecules from very close, and what we discovered was shocking. We could say it was electrifying. It had to do with electric fields. Let me explain. So you've probably at some point wrapped a balloon against your sweater and then see how it attracts your hair, making it look very spiky. That's called static electricity. And molecules do have that as well in a much smaller scale. Now, when we were using these similar metallic scaffolds, the metal was pulling the same energy in every case, but the rotaxanes on their own were generating more electricity, which is known to also change the strength of a bond, making it weaker or stronger, depending on the case. So what are the implications of this, you may ask? Well, a lot, huge. What if we could design some metallic agents that with some electrifying add-on, it would make the bond that we intend to break much weaker? This would speed up these very large-scale procedures by a lot, making them faster, and we would need to use less of these metals, which are not the healthiest thing out there. Sadly, still today, industry and chemical industry is a really polluting agent that contributes a lot to contamination and climate change. Every year, we are still breaking disastrous records with temperatures and all of these things that, well, are bad. As they said, I'm only 24 years old, but I intend to live a bit more in this planet, if possible, but there needs to be a planet for that. Now, time is running out, not only on the presentation, but also outside. And I think that we have to fix the problems we created, but I think that we can, achieving them in a more green, sustainable, and efficient way. At least that's what we're trying to do in our labs. So thank you very much for listening, and enjoy the rest of the evening.
Neil, thank you very much for this great message at the end.
So, Maja, what do you think speaks the loudest?
Definitely actions.
Okay, yeah. I meant scientific in scientific communication, when you're trying to reach as many people as possible.
Well, in that case, I would say that content speaks loudest. Surely we agree.
No, not really. I think that content is important, obviously, but it's even more important how you deliver it.
Okay, so you mean talking substance in the age of style, in a way. So okay. Is this your experience speaking after 10 years of stand-up, I assume?
Yes, I could also learn about it there, but no, I have conducted another scientific research to back this up.
Seriously? I mean, I thought you studied chemical engineering, not acting.
Actually, the story behind is like the story behind this building we're in. Started in chemistry, ended up in acting. But not, this is my private research on communication, a little bit closer to home.
Okay, now you have my attention. Tell me more.
It's very long research. I will probably never complete it, really. It's in communication with my better half. Mm-hmm. Most of the times, it does not matter what I say, but how I say it.
Yeah?
Whenever things get serious, it's all about, I don't like your tone. Don't talk to me like that. All of a sudden, the content isn't important. It's all about the delivery.
Okay, yeah. I would agree. The real business of communication, I guess, lies lower than just in our head. It sits maybe here in our gut. This is why we are so sensitive about humor. This is why we are so sensitive about intuition. And maybe it goes even lower to the lower organs. This is why we pay so much attention to image.
And this is why we spend so much time scrolling through images.
On our mobile phones, yeah.
And I think it's just the right time to serve another Slovenia fact.
Did you know that 1.25 million people, or approximately 82% of Slovenians, between the age of 16 and 74, have a profile on at least one social network? They spend at least 1 hour a day on social media.
Looking pictures, as I said.
Yeah. And images will be silent assistant in the next presentation, where you guys in the audience will be asked for help too. Rodrigo says that he's originally from Brazil and now he studies in Portugal.
He will be presenting his work about life essential dilemma, Trump or Gaga.
Well, that's an important dilemma. And beside that, Rodrigo says that he will try to make sociology great again. Rodrigo, the floor is yours.
Hi. Hello, everyone. It's really nice to be here tonight. I'm very excited. I'd like to propose you a Q&A game, okay? I will make you a few questions. And I ask you to respond. Has you were a member of the LGBTIQ community, okay? So if you are already a member of the LGBTIQ community, that's okay. But if you are not, I'm going to ask you to respond as you were in other people's shoes, okay? So let's start. So first question, okay? We just had elections in Brazil last month. Okay, we had two candidates in the second term. And I always, just one thing, I always present option A and option B, okay? So option A, if you were a member of the LGBTIQ community in Brazil, would you were vote for? So option A, Jair Bolsonaro, which was the far-right candidate. Raise your hand if you were voting for Bolsonaro. Okay, nice. Option B. Raise your hand if you are going to vote for Lula da Silva, the left-wing candidate. Okay, pretty nice. Let's go to the second question. If you were an LGBTQ person, which of these people would be your biggest cultural inspiration, your cultural icon? So option A, raise your hand to me if it was going to be Donald Trump. Okay. option B, raise your hand to me if you would prefer Lady Gaga as your biggest inspiration. Okay, that's nice. I'm also into Gaga. So last question. If you were an LGBTQ person and you had to join a social movement right now, which social cause would you prefer, would you make your priority, okay, to go to the streets and fight for? So option A, raise your hand to me if religious freedom would be a priority for you. Okay, that's nice. Option B, raise your hand to me if sexual freedom and gender self-determination would be your priority. Okay, pretty nice. I see your priorities. So, your answers, just by contrast, I could say you guys most responded option B, okay? So, Lula da Silva, Lady Gaga, and sexual freedom and gender self-determination. It seems pretty reasonable to me, okay? I would say following the social perceptions, the social image, and even the social stereotypes we have towards LGBTIQ people and community. But what if I tell you that in the past years I've been studying, people, LGBTIQ people in Brazil, that would give exactly the opposite answer? That's the twist. So in the past years, I've been studying LGBTIQ plus right-wing and sometimes far-right activists in Brazil. So for many people that I interviewed, Jair Bolsonaro would be the better person to be president of Brazil for more 4 years. Donald Trump is the biggest inspiration. And religious freedom is more important for them to fight for than sexual freedom and gender self-determination. You are probably asking right now, Rodrigo, why, how it's possible. It doesn't make sense to me. And that's exactly what I've been studying, okay? So the first thing to say is that as human beings and social actors, we are plural. We can't be defined just for one identity, okay? We also have class background, we have racial background, we are immigrants or not, we have religion or not, and identity is not enough to define what we are going to fight for. For political sociology, for contemporary sociology, we are also looking for the meeting of, the complex meeting of all these identities, and also considering that each of us, we have different social paths. They are complex. You know, we migrate, we live in different places. We are in different social networks of friends, of the church, school, and all of that actually influence what we are going to fight for. So this is very complex. So it's not evident that all women are going to be feminist. All black people are going to fight for racial equality. And all immigrants are going to fight for reforms, okay, to have better immigrant laws. So this is what I've been studying. It's also not evident that all LGBTQ people are left-wing. They are also diverse, we like it or not. I hope you enjoyed this presentation. If you like it, my name is Rodrigo, my number is 7. If you didn't like, my number is 8 and my name is Luca, bye.
Thank you very much, Rodrigo, for this great, great presentation.
Yeah.
And now, another tip we have for you when it comes to communicating science is speaking with energy and emotion. So let people hear that you are excited about what you do. And here is, let's say, an experiment.
Okay.
So, Aleš, you will be my silent assistant now.
That I'm good at.
There is a coat from the lab.
Okay.
Could you be so kind and put that coat on, please? And there's also some other equipment from the laboratory, like glasses.
Okay.
Don't take too much time.
Yeah. Sorry.
Yeah, so you know that. You were studying chemistry, didn't you?
Chemical engineering.
Yeah, so you were
it's a difference, you know?
Okay, so put a coat on.
You know what my professor said? If you meet another chemist, you talk about mechanical engineering, because this is a mix of chemistry and chemical engineering. If you meet another mechanical engineer, you talk about chemistry. And if you meet another chemical engineer, you talk about sports.
Okay. Well, your coat is on now.
Yeah.
Put this, the glass, or at least the glasses on. Sure, mm-hmm. Great. And there is some other equipment.
Yeah.
Please bring it here, closer. How do you feel now?
I feel like my university professor.
Now, a question.
Novak, please come next week again.
A question for our audience, a very simple one. How do you feel about him? Would you hug him?
No.
Would anyone hug him?
That's a cruel game.
Sorry, Aleš. What about
you
if
won't
I add?
Hug me?
I will hug you, okay.
Ah, okay.
But what about if I add a little bit of emotion into this mixture here? Mm. Let's make a chemical reaction. If I tell you, let's say, about his motivations for science, or from the childhood on, or how he managed to save his teenage sweetheart in a laboratory explosion, or, for example, about his passions and fears for the humankind and so on. If I tell you all this, what do you feel about him now? Would anyone hug him?
She said yes. There's one person.
Can anyone demonstrate this hug, please? Renata, you said loud, I heard you.
Oh, hello, Renata.
Okay.
It works!
It works! So, the key message here is you can hug a scientist, and scientists are huggable people. Okay.
So emotions. The test for you tomorrow is hug a scientist. Just go and hug a scientist.
So, emotions, I would say, play a certain role. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, you say, now it's your turn, I guess.
Yes, okay. But you don't count. I always use this when it comes to producing. Is this about podcast?
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I'm producing a podcast. I mean, find me a person who is interested in content or in information.
It's me.
Really? You ever listened to a podcast before?
Yeah, I did.
Okay, you know how it's based?
Yeah.
First, okay. You're too nerdy. Okay. For example. First of all, you have a signed guest. You ask him what? What's he's doing? No, how was his day? And then you ask him how, if he's got a dog or a goldfish or something like that. Then, which details are personal, if you have this personal information, it comes closer to you. And then in the comment, then you comment on the politics and sports and a little bit of this and that. And after that, if you have any time left, you can also discuss some content. You know, like that, what does he do? And here is your podcast.
So, okay, understood. So it's also useful to explore the emotional side of an issue, if I understand correctly, yeah. And this is what we are going to do next. With next researchers, we are moving into politics again, and believe it or not, politics is emotional. People hope for their candidate, get frustrated about electoral losses, fear that we are wasting time, but more than that, people get increasingly emotional as members of their political group. They like or love people who share their views, and dislike or hate people who disagree with them.
So in the next presentation, we will learn how to make sense and reduce this effective polarization.
Its author, Luca Verstegen, who is originally from Germany, with no reason he has Dutch surname, but lives in Gothenburg, Göteborg, in Sweden, where he likes to read, write, do sports, and explore the Swedish wildness, like forests and islands.
He's happy to be in Ljubljana, especially as it is so much brighter than in Sweden, winter darkness.
Yes, this is true. The duration of daylight today is 1 hour and 40 minutes longer in Ljubljana in comparison to Sweden. But this doesn't mean that we are happier here just because of the longer sunlight exposure.
Here comes the Slovenia fact.
So, while Swedes rank 7th on the World Happiness Index in 2021, Slovenes are on the 22nd place among 142 states included.
Yes, we are just one place higher than Saudi Arabia. No, this is the old data. After they beating Argentina, they're probably on the first. Yeah.
Okay. So, we spoke a little bit about emotions, and we love... They Hate is the title of the next presentation. Why do we live in systems divided by love and hate? We'll explain Luca Verstegen.
Happiness. Hate, love, and anger. Politics is emotional. Did you ever get angry at a politician or just hope that your candidate would finally win that important election? Or just laugh about Donald Trump? Could happen, right? So emotions are everywhere in politics. And I study one particular part of that, which is called affective polarization. And affective polarization describes the phenomenon that we increasingly like or even love people who share our political attitudes, but dislike or even hate people who disagree with us. Just look around. What party do you think people vote for? Is it left? Is it right? Is it center? Well, it doesn't really matter. As long as they support the same party as you do, you're quite likely to share preferences and lifestyles. However, as soon as you disagree with each other, you probably feel uncomfortable. And research from all over the world shows how consequential effective polarization is. Just imagine you want to apply for a new job and you hear that your potential new boss votes for a different party than you do. You're less likely to apply. Probably more important for all of us, we are less likely to be friends with a person and less likely to fall in love with a person if we know that that person votes for a different party than we do. Is it about that person then? No, it's effective polarization. We love and we hate. And this is not just in the US, right? This is everywhere. It's in Israel and the Netherlands, in Germany, and yes, I'm sure it's also in this room. Effective polarization is also in Slovenia. And you may wonder, well, how does that look like in friendly Slovenia? Well, just imagine you voted for Golob in the last election and you realize that the person sitting next to you voted for Janša. Or other way around, you voted for Janša and you date somebody and this somebody is really nice and smart and beautiful, but voted for the other guy. She's a 10, but. And this is what I do. Every day, I study emotions in politics, and my angle on that is from the radical right. I examine populist radical right parties, which combine a racist ideology with the claim to move away the power away from the self-interested, corrupt, lazy political elites sitting far away in Washington or Ljubljana doing nothing for us, the hard-working, ordinary people like you and me. Hard-working and ordinary. So what do? Well, I look into huge surveys asking people, what emotions do you actually feel when you support the radical right? And then they can rank, right, from 1 to 5. Is it fear? Is it anger? And I also find it's nostalgia. People who long for the way society was and the way people were are more likely to support the radical right. And that is quite interesting because research also shows that most of us actually tend to be nostalgic from time to time. However, we long for different things, right? We may long for our childhood, Christmas, our first car perhaps, but these things are not related to radical right support. It's really this longing for a society that has allegedly been better in the past than today that make people more likely to support this ideology. So you can really see here already that emotions drive societies apart. And then I also directly talked to radical right voters. In September 2021, I sat in the living rooms and backyards of German radical right voters, just asking them, what emotions do you feel when you think about the green left? And I can tell you there were loads of emotions going on. But what I actually found more interesting is that people were quite good at using these emotions in a way to create us versus them. So they would motivate their own view in all these nice, friendly, cool emotions. They would say, you know, we are caring, we are compassionate, we are loving. Actually, we love our women so much that we just vote for this party to protect our women from migrants. But then they would describe all these negative, uncool emotions to the other side. They would say, you know, but the green left, they are angry, aggressive, and disgusted. So people, emotions seem to make the game. Why do I research this? Obviously, you could say, well, it matters scientifically, right? Emotions are everywhere, politics is everywhere, and we are here as scientists to understand what is everywhere. But I think there's even a more important reason, a societal reason. Right now, our societies are divided, right? We are disrespectful and intolerant towards each other, and we really can't afford that, given that we have such big challenges like climate change and social inequality that we rapidly and efficiently need to take care of. And I was told that I could bring one or several objects to illustrate my talk, and I was like, yeah, what should I illustrate with emotions? Everyone knows how fear looks like. But then I thought a bit more, and I think I found one story that to me really shows how current aggression and false pride and anger drive politics, and how on the other side there are people counteracting this aggression with genuine fear and compassion and love. And I have this one story that shows this to me, and here's the object. So obviously with my research, I can't make everybody love each other, and that's probably not even desirable, right? But if my research more broadly in this talk also could contribute towards hating each other a bit less, that would be a great start. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Luca, for this great message. I think love more, hate less would be the perfect takeaway message for this slam. Wouldn't you agree?
But I'm really interested in the next topic.
In the last topic, actually, yeah, me too. Artificial intelligence is a topic that deserves more of our attention.
Although I don't really understand how machine learning works. I understand we can teach machine a lot of things, but deciding instead of us, I don't know.
But in a way, I think that it would be great if a machine could make certain decisions instead of us.
Really?
Yeah.
I like to decide for myself, but give me one example where the machine decision would be welcome.
For one, whenever I pass a refrigerator in the evening to check what's there, I would prefer the fridge to make the decision instead of me and lock the doors for me.
Okay, you have a point there. Or if my car made a decision, it would accelerate when I pass the fast food restaurant. Okay, I give you that.
Or, for example, if AI made my romantic decisions when I was younger, I could pass a few disappointments and find the right one earlier.
No, I wouldn't agree on that one, not at all.
Why?
Because those are decisions you really needed to be making by yourself.
Okay, so, Aleš, you are full of wisdom tonight, and another man full of wisdom is also Marco Esnobile from Ca' Foscari University of Venice, Department of Environmental Sciences, Informatics and Statistics. He is the Associate Professor of Computer Science, and he is not sure whether we should let machine learning do the decisions in delicate matters.
Tonight he will present his topic, Make the Box White Again, How to Achieve Interpretable. Yes, like you said, AI.
But first, do you remember what we played each time when a competitor came to the stage? Can we hear it once more? Okay. The author of this piece is Marco, who does in his free time plays music on the keyboard. So maybe he will tell us also something about that. But as we said, tonight the topic that Marco will explain us is the Make the Box White Again, how to achieve interpretable?
Yes.
Interpretable AI. Marco.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. You're alive? You're still there? Okay. You're ready for the last topic? Okay. So we hear every day in the newspapers, in the news, that artificial intelligence is doing amazing things. Okay. We see that it's capable of doing outstanding tasks. Okay. We keep pouring data into these algorithms, and then we can solve problems faster and often more accurately than human operators. Okay, so many tasks that used to be exclusive prerogative of humans now can be done by machines. Okay, and this is an amazing feat, an amazing achievement for humanity, and it's a scientific breakthrough. Still, there are some issues. Okay, and the issue is the following. Behold, an artificial intelligence. Look. This thing is an artificial intelligence. So it's a black box. We cannot know the inner motivations of this thing. Okay, we can just enter some data into this thing and get some suggestions, decisions, or predictions for us. This is totally fine. Okay, so we don't need to know the explanations, the motivations behind this thing, when, for instance, we are using a neural network that is able to discriminate, recognize animals, right? We don't care how this thing can distinguish between, a cat and a tiger, right? We don't care. Or we don't care why a self-driving car is able to recognize traffic signs in the streets, as long as it does it correctly and, fast, fast enough to not get killed. Is it important that we know why a turbine can break down? Okay. Well, we are getting closer to the motivation of this talk, okay? But there are even more complicated situations that are way more sensitive, okay? Think about medicine or biomedical applications, okay? You have the right to know why this thing is telling you that, I don't know, you cannot receive a treatment, okay? Or you shouldn't undergo a surgery. Do you trust a system that just says yes or no and doesn't provide you any explanation whatsoever? Or imagine that you want a mortgage and the black box says no. And you ask, oh, right, why? And it keeps saying no, just no. That's the only explanation you get. Well, this is, becomes a delicate matter, okay? So we have the right to get explanations in some sensitive domains. So it's not surprising that a lot of effort is being spent to open the black box and try to figure out how it's working. But there are additional motivations to figure out, to motivate this research. For instance, the data used to train this black box might be biased. And this makes the algorithm biased, okay? The algorithm has no fault. It's just the data you used that is biased, and it's making an unbiased algorithm out of it, okay? And so maybe there are some biases in our society, and we don't want to perpetuate those in our algorithms, okay? And also, sometimes the black box is able to give answers that are really accurate, I mean, amazingly accurate, for the wrong reason, okay? There is this cool, wait, AI fact. There is this cool story about a neural network that was outstanding in recognizing animals, okay? But when they analyzed the results, they figured that the neural networks were recognizing wolves because of the snow that was surrounding the photos, okay? So they trained the machine learning algorithm using pictures of wolves in the snow. And so the neural network learned to recognize wolves because it was an animal in the snow. Okay, you take out the snow from the pictures, the performances break down. How do you figure that if you don't know the motivation of the neural network? Okay, so you can't. The answer is you can't. So there is a lot of research trying to create an explainable AI. Explainable AI is the idea that the black box will explain the motivations to us. Okay, and within this context, our research focuses on interpretable AI, which is a different field. And in interpretable AI, you can easily interpret what are the motivations inside this thing, okay? So you keep creating AI systems by pouring a lot of data, okay? And our algorithms try to find patterns, try to find clusters, try to find some patterns in your data that can be connected together, okay, to create a sentence in a human understandable form that explains why this thing is telling you that, okay? So there is a delicate trade-off that you need to find between the complexity of the explanation and the accuracy you're achieving, okay? An explanation that is super verbose, super long, and very complicated is not useful either, okay? You want something that goes straight to the point and you can understand easily. If you achieve that, and we are trying to go there, then the doctor can have an explanation, agree on the explanation of the black box, which is now white, okay, it's a white box. And when he agrees, or she agrees, on the explanation provided by the AI, can explain that to the patient, generating trust, trust towards the system, trust towards the AI. We keep reading amazing things about artificial intelligence. Now that the AI is white, we can also know why. Thank you.
Marco, thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So these were all 9 brilliant presentations presented by 9 fantastic slammers. Let's remember all 9 again. So
yeah, I will invite all 9 here again, here on the stage, very quickly. Can you join us? so that maybe people, you sitting in the in this whole theater hall, or maybe at home watching us via stream, you're thinking, oh, what was he saying about? What was his topic? How did he look like? Oh, I like that presentation, but can't remember the name. So okay. Guys, now is the last time you have your chance to persuade people so that they remember you. These are very short instructions. Just give us your name, your university, and just in a sentence or two, what did you talk about tonight? So you, we will start with the only Slovenian among competitors here.
We also need
here.
Credit card number with the code. Okay.
Okay, I'm Mateusz Dular. I come from University of Ljubljana, and I was talking about cool bubbles.
I'm Michela Garzulo from TU Dresden, and I was conversing with AI.
Luca Festing, University of Gothenburg. I was talking about emotions and politics and everything we feel every day.
I'm Marco Nobile from the Ca' Foscari University of Venice. I was trying to convince you that AI is really bad.
I'm Neil for the University of Warwick. I was not talking about numbers. I was talking about how chemistry can make the world more sustainable.
I am Rodrigo from the Nova University of Lisbon, and I was talking about LGBTIQ plus right-wing activism.
Hi, I'm Maximilian of Vrije Universiteit Brussels, and I was talking about how you can compare a wind turbine and a piano to detect out-of-tune vibrations.
Ivan Lojudice from Universitat Pompeu Fabra, Barcelona, and I gave a presentation about banner nationalism and symbols.
Daniela Constantin from Babeș-Bolyai University in Cluj-Napoca, Romania. And I talked about how we can use quartz to understand the changes in the Earth's surface.
Okay, thank you very much. Give it up for all the nine competitors, researchers, slammers. I think this is this will be a very tough choice, I guess.
Probably. We'll see.
Now, so yeah, these are the people that now ask for your help. Voting will start in a minute, but before, let's clear the rules again. On your seats, you received the QR code. When you scan it, it leads you directly on the webpage where you can pick the slammers, or three slammers that impressed you the most. For those that watch us through stream, please find the link on the Science Onto the Street site or here. Here, I need to apologize for those that watched us via stream because there was a problem on YouTube. And now we switch to Facebook, so you can reach us on Facebook. And thank you very much for your patience. And once again, apology for those that maybe lacked a presentation or two via YouTube. So everyone can contribute to the ranking through the televoting system. You have 5 minutes to decide. After that, the online voting will close.
The jury and the online voting each award on independent set of points, and the final result consists 60% from the jury vote and 40% from the online vote.
And after the voting closes, the team that looks after the voting system needs approximately 5 minutes to collect all the results. And then in that time, after the voting, you are kindly requested to also take part in the challenge on Menti. You will see the link here on the screen, or on your seats, there will be QR codes as well. So this comes after the voting. So the voting starts
in right now.
Okay, so we are back in 5 minutes. Thank you very much now, and wish you a nice decision and good luck to all the competitors.
Thank you.
Aha, tohle bom se dala stran.
Thank you.
Yes, okay, how this thing works. So 5 minutes are over. Now the voting has stopped, is closed. Decisions have been made. We have another 5 minutes, so the team can collect all the results, all the points, adds them together, and then we will get the final result and, of course, the winner. But before that, as I said, we have 5 more minutes, and in that time, in the meantime, I ask you for help. You can go on mentimeter.si. There you will also find the code 89317763. If you go onto that page, so mentimeter.si, you can find a question there and you can answer it. Please do answer it, so that at the end we will get a lot of thoughts, a lot of ideas. What can science do so that the world can become a better place? So we need your ideas, we need your suggestions, and so on. So in that 5 minutes, when the final result is being counted, we ask you for help. And maybe we can revive this piano again. So where is... Yes, sure. So we need some music from a real scientist. You can play it a little bit before we heard Amélie. And what we will hear now?
So I'm gonna play Amélie Poulain again, but the full version this time, no breaking. I'm gonna play Clocks from Coldplay, and if I have the time, I'm gonna play a bit also the Fürelise from Beethoven.
Okay, so you have a concert here as well. So nice concert, you listen it, and meanwhile you can answer the question. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So, yeah. This is not as visible as we thought it would be. Sorry. Aha, what is this? Aha, they put it here.
It's so, the police.
Yeah, we can read it aloud, some of your ideas, Aleš, here.
Yeah.
So the most of you thought about how can we make a world better place with science is with knowledge, sustainability,
understanding,
dialogue,
collaboration,
crazy discussions,
health,
truth,
innovation,
solving,
beer? No, is this beer? No.
Curiosity.
Otherwise you have to, you know, I'm a little bit older.
Okay, I can do it like this.
Yes. Critical thinking.
Quality.
Clean water.
Improving.
Credibility.
Then we have solidarity.
Eye-opener.
Stay open.
Democracy.
Better communication.
End of poverty.
Cleaning the world.
Sustainability.
Preserving credibility.
We're going to read all of them?
No, just let's make five more.
Five more, okay. Examples.
Then we have climate change.
Limits.
And here's one that's written, Shrek knowledge.
Okay. Mental health.
New drugs. And
so on.
Inspiration. Okay. There were some inspiring ideas here. Thank you very much for your ideas. Now, here comes the most important part of this year's Science Slam.
We finally get something to eat. No?
No, Aleš. I think it's time now to announce the results, to announce who is the winner.
Ah, okay. You have the results?
Yes, I have them here.
You have all the... No, before they were listed, they were introduced again before the voting.
I don't want to be here alone with you on the stage. I think it's time to call them for the third time.
For the third time.
All the competitors, okay. All the researchers, please join us here on the stage. Yeah, so tonight, here we're Mikaela Gargiulo with a presentation, Hey You, Conversing with AI.
Mateusz Dular, Faculty of Mechanical Engineering, Slovenia, Harnessing the Power of Bubbles.
Then Maximilian Veil from Vrije Universiteit, Brussels, from Belgium, Smart Infrastructure Will Never Stay Out of Tune. Then Ivan Lo Giudice, yes.
Giudice.
Universitet from Barcelona, Spain, Banal Nationalism.
Daniela Constantin Babes Boliai University, Cluj Napoca, Romania. Come, let's see the world in grain of sand.
Then Neil Roche-Vidal from University of Warwick, Belgium, electric fields as reactivity boosters in chemistry.
Rodrigo Cruz, Universidade Nova de Lisboa, Portugal, Trump or Gaga? Do we have a winner?
Then Luca Verstegen, University of Gothenburg, Sweden, We Love, They Hate, Emotions in Politics.
Last but not the least, Marco S. Nobile, KFOR, Cari University of Venice, Italy. Make the box white again. How to achieve Maya?
Interpretal AI.
AI.
And finally,
the moment. Here are the results.
Here comes the moment we've all been waiting for.
Yes.
The online voting worked. The jury decided. Was it hard?
Yes.
Yeah, I guess. So we have the final results here.
So let's
what
start.
What was said was said.
Start with the third place, right?
Yeah. Let's start.
The third place goes to. Just say it.
Maybe we can play the piano.
Yes, of course.
Because I it's Maximilian Whale, smart infrastructure will never stay out of tune.
Thank you very much.
Okay, just stay here, stay here.
The second place.
The second place. Whew.
Goes to.
Wow, it's so quiet.
Why?
Why are we so quiet?
How was the football? Belgium and...
okay.
Not that result.
Let's go to the second place. So, will you say it or shall I say it?
Just say it.
We can say it together.
No,
just second place goes to... We love, they hate... Luca Verstegen, Emotions in Politics. Thank you, congratulations. Oh, I'm so pleased that I have the first chance of taking a photo with this, all these winners here. Thank you.
Okay, so the winner is... You're going to be very surprised.
I think it's great
that I can say the winner is because I can pronounce everything. This is his name and everything. So the winner is Mateusz Dular.
Harnessing the bubble, the power of bubbles from the University of Ljubljana. Congratulations. Now, we wait for two things, I guess. One thing is the speech of a winner, and the second thing is that trick that lasted too little. So I think they are having in mind, they want to see the repetition of that trick.
Which one?
With the fire.
I burned my hair a little bit. I can try.
Yeah. So yeah, give a large round of applause so that we can see that. And now you can prepare your cameras. Now you can prepare your mobile phones or whatever. Because for the first time we saw how it lasted very, very
quickly.
Short amount of time. So Mateusz will now show us the trick again.
Yeah, but in the meanwhile, when we're waiting for the everything to... Okay, is this Metan? I'll pass.
Maybe we can hear some Marco music as a background.
I prefer maybe the best music for this experiment would be "We Didn't Start the Fire." Okay, so this is test also for how the smoke alarms work. Okay, that's great. We don't do that in stand-up comedy.
What?
Fire?
Okay, now, okay.
Ready? Are you ready? Woohoo! Can
Bravo.
I try?
Are you sure, Aleš?
No, I'm not sure. But why not? You only live once. Where are the bubbles?
Woohoo! So even stand-up comedians play with fire.
Yeah.
Well, okay, thank you very much, Mateusz. And now I would ask you for another challenge, just to say a few words for us. If you have some other message for us as a winner.
This is the question for a sports journalist. How do you feel?
Like on top of the world.
Thank you. I'm not sure if it was a fair play because I was on home court. It was really nice listening to all the talks. They were really amazing, even the politics, which I don't like, sorry. But I loved your talk, so thank you for the opportunity. Actually, I wanted to do my PhD student to do this talk, but he didn't want to do it, so next time it's on you. And yeah, thank you for coming. It was a real pleasure to do this. Something a little bit more stupid than usual, what we do, the dull life of scientists. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mateusz. And we believe in the power of bubbles, don't we now?
Yes.
And for the final part of the script?
Yeah, we would like to invite organizers on the stage too. Please come join us on the stage. Tonight's event wouldn't be possible without so many amazing people.
Yes, and in their name, I would like to give a word to Kristina Jager from the Science Onto the Street Society to say a few words. Kristina.
Thank you,
ma'am. Okay, no. Is it okay?
Not yet. Okay, now I'm the one.
No.
Do you hear me?
No. It's not. Sorry. Like this. Ah, Mateusz was very strict.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yes, thank you, Aleš and Maja, for leading the slam so good, as always. Thank you all slammers for joining us to agree to perform. It was a great pleasure. We met on Zoom twice, you know, it's like meeting on Zoom is not really personal, but when they met today for the first time, they were really a team. They were working with each other, they were collaborating, so they were really great. So give them another applause. They're all winners. So another thank you goes to EUTOPIA team from University of Ljubljana because of, without their invitation, there would be no international slam right now happening. So thank you, the team. I would like to call them on the stage so you can meet them in person. So it is Haris, Tiasha, Neva, Iris, and Simona. I hope that they didn't left anyone. Thank you. Thanks. Thanks, EUTOPIA team. I hope we will do another one. So now the next is the Science on the Street team, a big team that were able to organize this. We were a bit nervous today because always something goes wrong. If it doesn't go wrong, everything will go wrong on the event. So I would invite Petra, Sasha, Majda, Martin, Eva, Spila. I hope we are all now. Aha, and yeah. And yeah, I will say. And one more. There is Ange, who is in Japan right now, in Okinawa. He's on postdoc, and he also participated right now, in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
Yes. Thanks, Ange.
Okay.
We bow. So, last but not least, our technicians in backstage. So there is light designer Aljaš, sound technician Domen, director Tomáš, and our video lectures team, who they always help us. Today they apologize because of the stream went down, but you know, these things happen. No one is perfect. We solved it through the Facebook, and also for everybody who missed first and second talk, in 2 hours, everything will be back on YouTube, so you can watch it again. And the team from video lectures are Matthias, Simon, Nace, and Jakob. Let's give an applause for them too. And now I give the word to Maja and Aleš to finish as they started. Perfect.
Okay. So,
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks to all the fantastic slammers. We wish you all the best in your future career. Thanks to the members of the tonight's jury. And especially thanks to you that joined us here in the theater hall of the Agora Fateur, and of course those that were all tonight via stream on the YouTube and on the Facebook. It was an adventure. We learned a great deal. And what is most important, we had fun.
Thank you, good night, and see you on another Science Slam.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
We can give this one just to finish it. Oh.